Hello, everyone. It's so good to be here together this morning. We're glad that you have joined us here or online. Would you please stand to your feet? We're going to open our time together worshiping the Lord. Goodness, I would be desperate without your love, slave to the darkness if it wasn't for the cross. You have won me with your kindness, chased me down.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Luke, and I just want to welcome you guys here. If this is your first Sunday, I want to extend a special welcome. Thank you so much for coming. We're very excited to worship with you. So welcome, welcome, welcome. Hopefully everyone was able to grab a little program on the way in. We're going to go through a few things in here, and it's just full of information about what is going on in our church. So one of the inserts has a few announcements. The first one, I just want to welcome Ken and Tina Moberg. They are the interim pastors that we just hired. This is actually the first Sunday, and that's super exciting. I'm excited for where we're going as a church. So just want to welcome them, and he will be preaching today on walking with Jesus through his final week on earth. A few other announcements. The Eau Claire Marathon Weekend. We have historically, every single marathon weekend, taken that opportunity to serve Eau Claire and provide, well, I guess not provide, but serve water to the runners for race weekend. The funny thing is that happens on Sunday mornings. And so we are not going to be here on Sunday morning for the race weekend. Instead, we will be worshiping Sunday evening, April 30th at 5:30 here. So instead of Sunday morning, don't show up because we're not going to be here. We're going to be out serving water, and we would love it if everyone would be able to come. It's a really, really fun time and a beautiful picture of serving our community, or beautiful picture of Jesus by serving our community. So that is Sunday, April 30th. Another announcement in April is 412 Spring Retreat is coming up, and we need to be registered as soon as possible. So if you have a youth, and this is something that they would love to do, it's going to be an absolute blast. There's going to be some solid teaching, lots of fun, probably little sleep and way too much candy, and it's going to be great. So students, please come talk to me or another one of the 412 leaders, and we can get you signed up. Again, that's going to be April 21st and 23rd. We have a communication card. I'm going to pull that out right now. I'd love it if everyone would fill this out, whether this is your first time or you've been coming for years. Please take a moment to fill out some information on here, just a little bit of information about yourself. And then on the back, there's a spot for comments or prayer requests. And we take these very seriously and pray for these every single week. So please, take advantage of this, and when you're done filling it out, you can slip it right into the seat back right in front of you. If you're in the front, you're going to have to reach behind. But you can just plop it right in that thing, and we're going to just take a quick second here to do it. And just so you know, today is April 2nd. Not April Fool's, Nora. She was mad at me that we missed April Fool's, and I said, well, today's April Fool's. Did you know that? No. It's late April Fool's joke. All right. While you guys are finishing that up, I'm going to invite up Adrienne, and she's going to give us an announcement from the missions team.
Good morning. My name is Adrienne Cayley, and I'm the team leader for the missions team here at the Bridge Church. And this morning, I want to introduce you to Matt and Christina Hoffman. Many of you probably know them, but I know some of you do not. Matt and Christina are longtime members of the Bridge Church. Christina started here at the Bridge as a high schooler, and Matt joined us a few years later. Together, they are active on the worship team, working with Bridge Kids. They started the resettlement team. But here's the thing. As much as we love having them here with us at the Bridge and appreciate their service to us, we'd really like to see them leave us and engage in their calling as missionaries to the Middle East with Reach Global. Matt and Christina have been working to move to the Middle East as missionaries for the last few years. Throughout the pandemic, navigating the medical needs of their oldest child, the birth of their youngest child, they have never wavered from their conviction that God was calling them to serve him in missions. I'm not sure if you realize this or not, but the Bridge Church is the Huffman's sending church. That means that we have some special responsibilities to them. One of them is to support them as a church body in prayer. How are we going to do this? Well, for the month of April, we are going to have a prayer push for the Hoffman family. We are praying that God will help us to love them well these last few months and then push them right out the door. And I will tell you, in talking to them these last few weeks, they are ready to go. The Hoffmans have given us 5 specific prayer requests that you will find in your program. It looks like this. Please take these requests with you when you leave this morning and commit to praying for them throughout this month. There are 5 requests listed, so you can pray for 1 request each day of the work week and double up on weekends. Or there are 5 Sundays in April, so you can choose to pray thoroughly for 1 request each week. However you choose to do it, please choose to pray for the Hoffmans this month. We are asking our youth group and our growth groups to get involved and be praying as well. The goal is for everything to be in place for Matt and Christina and their kids to leave for the Middle East in June. Also, mark your calendars for April 23rd, because as part of our prayer push this month, we are hosting a lunch after the service for Matt and Christina to share more specifically with us about their ministry and about their plans. We would love to have as many of you there as possible. And additionally, you will find them serving throughout the church and in the lobby at different points this month. And one more thing before I lead us in prayer for the Hoffmans. Last week, as one of her final thoughts to us, Sue Kellen encouraged the bridge to grow in prayer and community. This is one opportunity for us to put that appeal into action. The very act of us worshiping together in this building after years of praying is a testimony to what we can do when we join together in prayer. So let's join together in prayer right now and throughout this month for the Hoffman family and watch what God will do. Let's pray. Oh, Father, you are good. Your ways are good. We are not worthy to come before you except through the blood of Jesus. Our hearts are heavy for those in the Middle East who do not have that knowledge, who do not yet know the goodness of our God and the sacrifice made for their sins. We thank you for placing a burden for these people in the hearts of Matt and Christina. We thank you for their willingness to leave the comfort of their home, their family and friends, and this church to fulfill the calling you have put on their lives. Lord, I pray that Matt and Christina will receive such an outpouring of blessing from you during this month that they can draw on it when they face challenges in the weeks and months to come. Meet their needs, the ones we know and those that are yet unknown. I ask you to make us as a church body steadfast in prayer to them, for them. We love you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Adrian. Perfect. Well, we are going to continue worshiping here, and I'm going to pray for our service before we start. So why don't you bow your heads again? We'll keep praying. Lord, you are good. And boy, that last song was just beautiful. Our shame was met with mercy. What a beautiful line. And Jesus, I just thank you for the mercy that you bring. Also, the power of sin being overcome in that was another beautiful line. And Lord, I thank you that we know that. And Lord, with the Hoffmans desiring to go overseas, Lord, just the exact example of fulfilling the Great Commission and teaching people about you, Lord, I pray that you would push them out. Lord, get that final support raised, all the tickets and everything that need to be done, and allow them to go do that. Lord, speaking of the Middle East and overseas, Lord, I just pray for the people of Ukraine. Boy, they're going through so much, and Lord, I pray that you would protect those people who have nothing to do with this war other than where they live. Lord, I pray that you would protect them and physically, but also spiritually, Lord. I pray that through this, that your light would shine, that your love would prevail, and that people would come to know you through this this terrible war. Lord, I also pray for Jerry and Sue. This is the first Sunday not attending the bridge. And Lord, I pray for their hearts. I pray that you would protect their hearts. Lord, I pray that your love would be very tangible this morning. Lord, I pray that they are taking the first Sunday just to rest in their loafers and pajamas and worshiping you in that, Lord. Lord, I thank you for the legacy that they've brought us. And Lord, I'm excited for where we're headed in that. But Lord, just bless them. Lord, I pray for today. I pray that we would be able to come into your throne room and worship you with joy and thanksgiving despite what might be going on in our lives. We might have had a phenomenal week and a lot of exciting things. We also might have had a lot of hard things. And Lord, I pray that you would teach us to just lay all of those things at the cross, good or bad, and come into your presence and worship you because, Lord, you deserve it. Jesus, we love you. Amen.
We're going to continue our time of worship and song. Would you please stand and join us again? Philippians 2, 9 through 11. We're going to turn our eyes to Jesus here. And God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Jesus is worthy of all of our praise and our song this morning.
Your heart.
next song is a little bit new for us. And it's a call to lift our eyes to behold the beauty of Christ. And it's it's inspired from the scripture from 2 Corinthians. We'll put that up there. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. And let's sing, Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery. You this morning, and we're so thankful for you. Thankful for this vision that we can have of our future, our hope that we have in you. And we just love you, Lord. And just pray for the rest of our time together that you would be glorified and that we would turn our hearts to you this rest of this time together. In your name we pray. Amen. You can take a seat.
Good morning. It's good to be with you. We had 14 people complete the membership class last Sunday night. And Pastor Jerry finished strong. In the morning he was honored. In the evening he was teaching again. And what a great strong finish. I would like to invite those people. 12 of them are with us this morning. 2 of them aren't because of a sick child. But come on up and join me here on the platform just for a minute, if you would. While they're coming, let me just mention what they've kind of been through. How many sessions did y'all have? 8 sessions of this, where they talked about the distinctives of the Bridge Church, mission, vision, values, and then they talked about what the Evangelical Free Church holds as its doctrinal statement. And Jerry unpacked all of that for them over these 8 sessions together. And so my joy is to be able to welcome you and to introduce myself to you as I introduce you to your new congregation. So Abby Broughton. Hi, Abby. I'm Ken. Nice to meet you. This is great. Sharla. Where's Sharla? Hi, Sharla. I'm Ken. Great to meet you. David and Eliza Easker. Hey. Good to meet you. Brian and Kimberly Jensen. Super. Wonderful. Cassidy and Dylan Howell on the end. Okay. Welcome. Welcome. Now, the Sewells are not able to be with us. Do we have a slide of the Sewells? Picture? No? There they are. So welcome the Sewells. That's Adam and Bobby. And then Jason and Janessa Stromberger. And I knew Janessa a long, long time ago. And Jerry and Jan Wagner. Jerry without the cane. No, there's 2 Jerrys without canes. So at any rate, just good to have you with us. This is an exciting time. I love to see what's happening at the Bridge and how people are coming to faith in Christ and stepping into the responsibilities of membership. We do have some questions for you. This is kind of the final exam here. And the correct answer is in the affirmative, okay? Just a hint. Okay, so let me just ask you, do you confess your faith in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, and do you desire to follow Him in pursuing full devotion to Christ? If so, say, I do. Do you declare your intentions to live in harmony with the mission, vision, core values, and the statement of faith of the Bridge Church? If so, say, I do. Do you commit to pursuing personal spiritual growth and practicing love for one another in your church family? If so, say, I do. And then finally, do you promise to support the Bridge Church by your faithful attendance, by serving in ministry, and by giving generously as God has prospered you? If so, say, I do. Great. Well, it's my joy then to welcome you into membership. The Apostle Paul wrote in Romans chapter 15, starting at verse 5, "May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you a spirit of unity among yourselves as you follow Christ Jesus, so that with one heart and mouth you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you in order to bring praise to God." So let me pray for you. Father, thank you for these people who have expressed their desire to be a part of the family here at the Bridge. And I just pray your rich blessing on each one as each one steps into a role that you have designed them for. And help us as a body to recognize these new members of the body and to honor them and to encourage them and help them grow as we seek to serve you together. So bless this church body as we seek to live out the mission that you have given to us and be glorified in us, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give them a hand as they come back. Welcome. Thank you. And we will let the kids go to Bridge Kids now as well. So kids, you can go and look forward to seeing what you learn at Bridge Kids. I had a great visit yesterday with Pastor Jerry. We spent some time together just kind of doing some briefing and debriefing, and he gave me this. This is a runner's baton, and he said, this is for you. And it says, lead pastor of the Bridge Church. And, you know, I watched Jerry run his leg of the race faithfully these past 15 years. Got to watch it from a distance, but I can testify that he ran faithfully. Now he's passed the baton. And I look forward one day, maybe a year and a half or so from now, to handing this baton off to the next runner. And so as we pray for Jerry and Sue, I would encourage you, pray for me and pray for the one that God has designated who will be the next runner. God has him chosen. It's our task to discover who that is, to find him, to recognize him for who he is, and then to welcome him as he leads his leg of the race of faith that we run here as a family of God. So welcome your prayers as I run mine. Let me just open in prayer as we turn to God's word. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for how it speaks to us so freshly. And I pray that as we approach it now, it would be with eyes wide open to what your word has to say to us, eager to receive it, eager to apply it, and eager to live this week in such a way that you receive glory and honor from our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Today is Palm Sunday. Next Sunday will be Easter Sunday. We are in a season called Lent. And Lent begins on Ash Wednesday, 40 days before Easter Sunday. And a little quiz, what precedes Ash Wednesday? What's that Tuesday called? Fat Tuesday. Yeah, it is kind of for those who lay aside some things, give up some things for Lent. It is one last opportunity for indulgence. There is an American city that's kind of made a legend of Fat Tuesday, and that city is New Orleans, and the event is called Mardi Gras, which is French for Fat Tuesday. And so we're in this season of Lent, and it all culminates next Sunday on Easter Sunday. There are some people who pay real particular attention to the seasons of the church calendar. To specific Sundays. Each Sunday has a specific function, a specific identity. And there are other days throughout the Christian calendar or the liturgical calendar, as it's sometimes called, that stand for particular things. We typically kind of jump in at Christmas and Easter, and we don't pay attention to that calendar for the rest of the year. But some people really do. I had a professor in college who was really into liturgy, and he was really into the liturgical calendar, and each day had its own function. Each Sunday, there was never any question about what to preach on a Sunday, because there's this book called what's it called? Help me out here, somebody. at any rate, it'll come to me. There is this book that tells you exactly what to preach every Sunday of the year. The lectionary, thank you. Yeah, had it yesterday. So the lectionary tells you exactly what to preach all year long. You don't ever have to worry about what to do. And, you know, I just thought that's a bit rigid. And so I decided as a sophomore in college to challenge my professor, which is never a really great idea. but sophomores in college don't know that, so we do it anyway. So I did, and I said, you know, the resurrection of Jesus is an established fact of history. And so I don't want to come to Good Friday feeling like I've got to be sad and wait to say yippee until Sunday. We are resurrection people, after all. We live in the light of the resurrection. We ought to be able to say yippee every day. And he thought about that for a second, and he said, you know, I don't think you can say yippee as effectively on Sunday if you haven't experienced the depths of what took place before that. I think he's got a good point. And this week gives us an opportunity to explore the depths of what happened prior to that first Easter Sunday, that first resurrection day. And so I hope as we walk through the days of this week in these next few minutes, that you'll jot some notes about scripture passages that go according to those days so that maybe you can experience some of those depths a little more fully this year, and then next Sunday morning we can say yippee together and really have something to rejoice over. So Palm Sunday begins this Passion Week or Holy Week. Our word passion isn't really ultimately about romance. Passion is about suffering. The Greek word pascho, you would probably spell it in English, P-A-S-C-H-O, pascho, is the word we get passion from, and it means I suffer. I suffer. And so this is Passion Week. This is Suffering Week. And there are a few passages of Scripture that you may want to jot down as you come back to those this coming week. But I'm just going to take Mark's Gospel, chapter 11, verses 1 through 11, to get us started on this. And that, by the way, if you grabbed one of the paperback Bibles, is on page 708. And so, and if you need one, there's some in the card in the entryway there. Feel free to pop up and grab one. So Mark chapter 11, and we'll just look at verses 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here shortly.' They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' And they answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven!' Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. That first day of Passion Week, Palm Sunday, named after the palm branches that people put in the pathway of Jesus, kind of like rolling out the red carpet for him in this event known as the triumphal entry. Jesus instructs his disciples to go and find this colt. It's amazing. There it is. And he tells them what to say if they're asked, and they do, and the folks release the colt. And so they bring the colt to Jesus, and he comes riding into Jerusalem on this donkey's colt. An onlooker that day might have seen that and said, "That's interesting. That reminds me of something one of the prophets said. And sure enough, the prophet Zechariah said this in chapter 9 of his little book. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly, and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So Jesus comes riding into Jerusalem, not on a white charger, but on the colt of a humble donkey. And what's going on here? Jesus is making a statement. Jesus is deliberately fulfilling an Old Testament prophecy about the Messiah. He's saying, I'm the Messiah. I am your king. I am the one you have been waiting for. All those prophecies that you've read about were pointing to me. It's a statement no one else could make. You ever thought about the number of Old Testament prophecies that Jesus fulfilled? Have you ever thought about the ones that he would have apparently had no control over? There are some that you or I could, by some stretch, maybe try to fulfill, but there's a whole bunch that you and I would have no control over. Think about some of them. Descended from David. That leaves a lot of people out. Born of a virgin, born in Bethlehem, taken to Egypt as a child, betrayed for 30 pieces of silver, crucified, people cast lots for his garment, buried in a rich man's tomb, resurrected. What are the odds that one person could fulfill all of those prophecies? And Jesus, in riding in and fulfilling one of them on purpose, is saying, it's me. It's me. There was a professor of mathematics named Peter Stoner who ran the odds mathematically of fulfilling just 8 of those prophecies. I don't know which 8 he picked, but he picked 8, calculated mathematically based on populations what the odds would be of one person fulfilling just 8 of the 456 prophecies. And he came to the conclusion that it would be a number equating to 1 in 10 to the 28th power. That's 10 with 28 zeros behind it. That number is so large. What it corresponds to is if you were to fill the entire state of Texas knee-deep with silver dollars and have one of them marked with just a dab of nail polish, put out there somewhere in the middle of the state of Texas, knee-deep in silver dollars, send someone blindfolded into the state of Texas to walk as far as he or she wanted to walk, and at some point to bend down and sort through and blindfolded pick up one silver dollar and find that it's the right one. The odds are amazing that one person could fulfill those. So Jesus is deliberately saying, that's me. I'm the one. I'm the king you've been waiting for. I'm the Messiah. And the people's response is to shout, Hosanna, Hosanna. And that means save us now. Save us now. They spoke better than they knew. The background for that is Psalm 118, verse 25, which interestingly in the NIV doesn't use the word Hosanna. It says, Lord, save us, which is what Hosanna means. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now, by the time of Jesus, Psalm 118 had become kind of just a song that you sing at festival time. It's kind of like a familiar hymn. You know, you can kind of go through the motions and sing it because you've sung it so many times before, and you're not really thinking about the words of what you're saying. You ever sung a hymn or a chorus and your mind just kind of goes on autopilot and you get to the end of it and you go, oh, there were some good lyrics back there. I should have been paying attention. And so that's the way it was with Psalm 118. And if someone would have asked them, what is this you're saying? They would have probably said, oh, we're just doing number 118. Just kind of on autopilot. But the word Hosanna means save us. And the meaning reveals the nature of Jesus' mission. He came to save his people. Not from the Romans, but from ourselves, from our own sin. And he would do that by laying down his life as the perfect sacrifice, taking our place, taking our sin upon himself. At the end of Palm Sunday, Jesus and the 12 go to the town of Bethany, about a 40-minute walk from Jerusalem. That was nothing in those days, 40 minutes of walking. That's, you know, real quick commute. And they would stay the night at the home of Jesus' dear friends, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, these three siblings. Lazarus, you'll remember from John 11, as the man that Jesus raised from the dead. And so they stay at the home of Mary and Martha and Lazarus, and Palm Sunday comes to a close. Monday dawns, and I call Monday of Holy Week or of Passion Week Manic Monday, because Jesus must have looked absolutely manic from the things that he did that day. Now, who remembers a song called Just Another Manic Monday by a group called the Bangles? You are really old. That's all I got to say. So Jesus looks manic at this. Take a look at the text again on page 708, Mark chapter 11. We'll just pick up at verse 12. The next day, so Monday, as they were leaving Bethany, Jesus was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, he went to find out if it had any fruit. When he reached it, he found nothing but leaves, because it was not the season for figs. Then he said to the tree, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And his disciples heard him say it. Sounds like Jesus having a bad day already. On reaching Jerusalem, Jesus entered the temple courts and began driving out those who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves, and would not allow anyone to carry merchandise through the temple courts. And as he taught them, he said, "Is it not written, 'My house will be called a house of prayer for all nations'? But you have made it a den of robbers." The chief priests and the teachers of the law heard this and began looking for a way to kill him, for they feared him, because the whole crowd was amazed at his teaching. When evening came, Jesus and the disciples went out of the city. Manic Monday, the cursing of the fig tree and the clearing of the temple, two events where Jesus is just looking like he's lost it. Both accounts have to do with judgment. First, the fig tree. Jesus sees this fig tree in the distance and heads toward it, and then he goes looking through the branches, and the disciples must have just been saying, "What is he doing?" Everybody knew it wasn't the season for figs, and yet here he is kind of looking through the branches for figs. Mark tells us what they all knew. It wasn't the season for figs. The trees would leaf out in March and April, but they wouldn't bear fruit until June. So Jesus is going through looking for fruit. What's that all about? Well, he is enacting a parable for them. He's putting this on for them to see. Here's a tree that looks healthy, but bears no fruit. And Jesus seizes on this image, this picture, to make a point about people who may look on the outside like they've got it together, but have no fruit in their lives. So that then leads to the next thing that he does, and that is he goes to the temple and just raises havoc there. He goes on to judge the people who have taken this place of worship and turned it into a place where worshipers get exploited. People would bring sacrificial animals into the temple to offer them as sacrifice for their sins, for their family's sins. And the priests would find reason to disqualify those animals. These would be animals that these people raised, that they raised up and brought with them from their homes. And the priest would say, "Now there's a blemish on that one." But I'll tell you what, I'll sell you an animal that is approved. And then they would sell these animals at exorbitant prices. The other thing that they would do is they would exchange ordinary currency for temple currency, and the exchange rate would just be crazy. And so these things, they're just exploiting people who are coming to worship. And Jesus calls it for what it is. He drives out the people that are selling animals, and he overturns the tables of these people exchanging the currencies. And the leaders then, Luke or Mark tells us, start looking for a way to kill Jesus. He is becoming that much of a threat to them. At the end of Manic Monday, Jesus and the 12 go back to Bethany, where Jesus is staying all week with his dear friends, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. There's a little epilogue to the Manic Monday story, though, and it comes in verse 20, and it tells us that the next morning, as they're heading back into Jerusalem, they pass this fig tree, and they find that it's withered from the roots. This tree that Jesus cursed the day before is completely withered up, and they take note of it. It had to make a huge impact on them in terms of what Jesus will do to those who only measure their spirituality by the externals and bear no fruit in their lives. Manic Monday ends. The next day dawns, Tuesday of Passion Week. I call it Troubled Tuesday. This is a longer section, and you can tell from the readings there. So I'm not going to read one of those for you, but I hope you'll come back to those. This is a longer section because it describes a very eventful day, a day filled with opposition from the religious leaders who are now intent on finding a way to discredit Jesus, to turn the crowds away from him, even to get him set up to be killed. So on Tuesday, Jesus and the 12 return from Bethany to Jerusalem, and there he finds the religious leaders ready to take him on. It's a day full of questions and challenges, and Jesus responds to their questions and challenges with parables that make them look really bad. It's been a day called the Temple Debate, the Pharisees and Jesus debating back and forth. And these religious leaders raise questions about Jesus' authority, and Jesus responds by telling parables. He tells a parable about two sons whose father wanted them to work in his vineyard, and one son goes, I'm not going to do that. But he ultimately goes out and does it, works for his dad. And then the other son says, yeah, Dad, I'll work the vineyard for you, but doesn't do anything, doesn't lift a finger to work in the vineyard. And Jesus sets that up to say, which group do you think you would be in? Which one is most like you? And the Pharisees would know. They're the ones who promised all kinds of things but didn't follow through with any of it. And Jesus tells them that tax collectors and prostitutes, the ones who said, no, I'm not going to do anything for you but end up doing it, they will get into heaven before these religious leaders. These guys look really bad in this parable. And he goes on to tell them another one. He tells them a parable about some people who have been entrusted with the care of a vineyard, and the only condition is they need to give the fruit to the owner. But they won't. They won't give the fruit to the owner. And he tells these people that the kingdom of God will be taken from them and given to others who will produce its fruit. Again, the religious leaders look bad. Tells them another parable about a marriage feast put on by a king whose son is getting married. Who's that point to? And the invited guests won't come. And so the king brings in people from the streets and keeps the invited guests out. Again, the religious leaders are pushed out and they look bad. In each of these stories, the religious leaders look bad and they try to trap Jesus with more questions, but just end up looking worse and worse all the time. Jesus finally pronounces a series of woes on the religious leaders, and those are recorded in Matthew chapter 23. He tells them how badly they've messed up what God designed to bring people to himself. And he calls them all sorts of names. He calls them hypocrites, blind guides, whitewashed tombs, a brood of vipers. He blames them for all of the innocent blood that's been shed from Abel to Zechariah, literally from A to Z. Can you imagine how desperately they wanted to get rid of him by the end of this day? Troubled Tuesday. Near the end of Troubled Tuesday, Jesus goes over to the Mount of Olives, which is nearby, and delivers a message that's known as the Olivet Discourse. And in that discourse, he talks about things to come, talks about the destruction of the temple that is to come. He talks about the signs of the end. He talks about the challenges his followers will face before he comes again. But he lets them know that he will come again, and he'll come again in glory. And after that, he and the 12 go back to Bethany to stay the night again with their dear friends, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Troubled Tuesday comes to an end. Silent Wednesday dawns. I call it Silent Wednesday because so little is known about that day. The Gospels are largely silent about that day. It would seem that Jesus chose to spend a quiet day in Bethany with his closest friends, Mary, Martha, Lazarus, and the 12. Think about it. Jesus knows what's ahead. He knows that when he heads back into the city on Thursday, that he won't be coming back to Bethany at the end of the day. Instead, he will be arrested. He will be tried. He will be condemned. He will be crucified, and he knows that. So how's he going to spend his last day? He'll spend it with those closest to him. What must that have been like? I imagine it as a pretty quiet day, not much said, maybe a lot of sighing. I remember reading in C.S. Lewis's Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe about Aslan on his way to the stone table, and he passes by the tent where little Lucy is, and she sees his shadow go by, and so she joins him, and they spend some quiet moments together, but he comes to the point of saying, you have to stay here. I have to go on alone. That's kind of the picture I get for Silent Wednesday. A day when he could just be with those who mattered most to him. Now, one of the things that is recorded about that day is that Jesus is invited to eat at the home of a man known as Simon the leper. Now, Simon the leper must have been a guy who was healed of leprosy, maybe by Jesus, and it seems that maybe he wanted to express his thanks to Jesus by throwing a meal in his honor. So he does, and that's recorded in Mark chapter 12. It's on page 710 if you'd like to follow along. Mark chapter 12, starting at verse 3. While he was in Bethany, reclining at the table in the home of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. Some of those present were saying indignantly to one another, "Why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages and the money given to the poor." And they rebuked her harshly. "Leave her alone," said Jesus. "Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want, but you will not always have me." She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. Don't miss the significance of this anointing. She is preparing him in advance for his burial. He would be the one who would sacrifice himself, and she was doing what she could for him. And then two verses that follow, verses 10 and 11, tell us of one other thing that happens that day. It happens in another place. Judas negotiates with the Sanhedrin to betray Jesus for 30 pieces of silver, the cost of a slave. And Jesus then overnights in Bethany one last time on Wednesday night. Thursday dawns of Passion Week. We call it Maundy Thursday. Again, each of the readings on the screen here reflect a longer section that we're not going to read right now, but could be helpful if you want to read them this week. I think you'll have a rich experience if you go through them this week. But they're back in Jerusalem on Thursday. Jesus sends Peter and John ahead to make preparations for the Passover that they will celebrate together in an upper room setting. And so they make arrangements, make sure that the table is set for them, that the food is prepared for them, that there will be near the door a basin full of water and a towel for the washing of feet. Here in Wisconsin, when we enter someone's home, we often take off our shoes so that we don't slosh snow all over their living room, but they would have dusty feet from wearing sandals on dirt roads, and so it would be customary before you enter, particularly before you have a meal, to wash your feet. And John chapter 13 gives us a little bit more detail about this. You kind of get this picture of the disciples walking in and seeing that basin and look around, and there's no rank and file household servant to wash their feet. And they go, I suppose I could wash my own, but nah. And they go and take their dirty feet to the table where they're going to eat. And one by one, they come in, and you can kind of see them looking at the basin and looking around and taking their place at the table. And finally, Jesus comes and sees that no one has bothered to wash feet. No one has done what a servant should do. And so he gets up and washes their feet. Their master washes their feet. The term Maundy Thursday comes from a Latin word, mandatum, which means mandate, a command. And the command is this. Jesus says, now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. That's the Maundy in Maundy Thursday. It's a command to wash feet. Some groups have taken it very literally, and they do foot washings. It's mostly ceremonial. They do it on special occasions. I take a less literal approach to it and suggest that Jesus had in mind that we should be willing to take up the humble task of an ordinary servant, that we seek to serve rather than to be served, that we are willing to do what others are not as we seek to serve in Jesus' name. There in the upper room, they observe the Last Supper. Jesus explains the elements of the Last Supper, that bread that symbolizes his body, the cup that symbolizes his blood. And this morning, in just a few minutes, we will reenact that scene in essence by observing the Lord's Supper together. From there, they go out to Gethsemane, where Jesus prays and the disciples fall asleep. Judas and the soldiers come, and Jesus is arrested. Then he is taken into Jerusalem, and the night is consumed with illegal trials that go all through the night, and Peter denies knowing Jesus. That all happens Thursday and Thursday night. Friday morning dawns. It just flows right on into Friday morning, Friday that we call Good Friday, where Jesus appears before Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor, who wants nothing to do with him. Pilate understands that Herod, the king of the Jews, appointed by Rome, is in town, and he gets rid of Jesus by sending him to Herod. Herod wants to see Jesus perform a miracle. Do a little trick for me, Jesus, and Jesus won't do it. So Herod sends him back to Pilate, and Pilate finally gives in to the demands of the crowd and orders that Jesus be crucified. 9 a.m. on Good Friday, Jesus is nailed to the cross. 12 noon, same day, when it should be brightest, darkness comes over the whole land. It's pitch dark. And then at 3 p.m., the end comes. Matthew and Mark tell us that Jesus gave a loud cry at that moment. And John tells us what it was he said. Tetelestai. It is finished. It is accomplished. Everything needed to deal with your sin and mine was accomplished at that moment as Jesus gave up his life. It is finished. Someone has suggested religion is spelled D-O. And you do, and you do, and you wonder if you've ever done enough to be okay with God. Religion is spelled D-O, and Christianity is spelled D-O-N-E. It's done. It's finished. It's accomplished. He's done it. All we need to do is put our trust in the one who has done this for us. 6 p.m., same day, Joseph of Arimathea, a wealthy man, asks for Jesus' body and lays it in Joseph's tomb. And Good Friday comes to an end. Saturday comes. I call it Sad Saturday. All we know about it is from a half a verse at the end of Luke 23. Verse 56 says, they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. That was it. That's all we know about that Saturday. But imagine it. These disciples were scattered. They are scared. It is a sad, dark day. They've got a lot of time to think. And they're thinking, this did not turn out the way it was supposed to. What's going to happen to us? Will they come for us next? And that's Sad Saturday. And then it's followed by Resurrection Sunday. And I will plan to see you next Sunday morning, and we can shout yippee together. Let's pray. Father, thank you for how your word explains to us what Jesus did that last week of his earthly ministry. And I pray, Father, that as we experience this Passion Week, that we would be attuned to what Jesus did on our behalf and experience the depths of that so that next Sunday we can experience the heights of Resurrection Sunday as never before. For your honor and glory, in Jesus' name, amen. Time now for us to take the Lord's Supper. This is not required. You are not required to be a member of the Bridge Church in order to take the Lord's Supper, to take these elements. But I would caution you that you must be one who has put their trust in Christ in order to do this. The Apostle Paul talks about this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And he says this, I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The apostle gives us a warning after that and encourages us to examine our hearts before we come to the Lord's Supper. And to see if there's anything there that needs to be confessed. And I would just encourage us all to take just a moment now for some self-examination and to agree with God about the sin in our lives, to confess it to Him, and to lay it at the foot of the cross. So let's just take a moment to pray. Father, we agree with you about the sinfulness of our sin. And I pray that we would not indulge it any longer, that we would not harbor it, that we would not entertain it, that we would not feed it, but that rather we would confess it and leave it behind, that you may be glorified by lives lived that are growing in Christ-likeness. Thank you for what Jesus did for us on the cross. Thank you for these elements that remind us of his body and his blood given on our behalf as the perfect sacrifice that takes care of sin once for all. I pray that if there's anyone here this morning that needs to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord, that that person would say, Lord Jesus, I see it now. I am a sinner and I need a Savior. Would you come into my life? Thank you for what you've done on my behalf. I receive you now. Live in me and I'll praise you forever. So thank you, Father, for these reminders in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd invite you to come and take the elements when you're ready. Take them back to your seat, and the worship team is going to sing and lead us. Just a word about the elements themselves. There's a little cellophane thing that the cracker is right beneath that, and then there's another tab to get you to the juice. And so come when you are ready. Thank you. for the Hoffman family, particularly this week, but all of this month. So take that insert home and pray for them. If you would like prayer yourself, we'll have a team up here to pray for you. Just come on up and share what you'd like prayed for with the team. So look forward to seeing you on Resurrection Sunday. We'll shout yippee together. God bless. Have a great week.